Welcome to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. We pray that this message will strengthen and encourage you. Now here's a message from Pastor Luke Cobray.
I believe that tonight's a really neat message. It's a deep principle for us to understand, and there's some very positive understandings for what I want to talk about tonight as I was going through the Word of God in my studies, and I believe that there's some big learning that we can take from this as far as things that we need to understand, a responsibility on our own part. Now, the title of tonight is Influence, just simply Influence. And you know, influence, I heard it said once like this before, influence isn't much about headlines. You know, if I was to ask each and every one of you, who was this last year's, Grammy-winning artist or, you know, Academy Award-winning best actor, many of you in this place wouldn't even know, wouldn't even remember who that person is, or let alone the year before. Why? Because influence isn't about a headline. Influence is about impact into somebody's life. And today I want to talk to you about the subject of influence and looking at what the Bible says about that. And I was thinking about it. You know, my wife and I, we just returned. You know, I guess we're pretty rustic. I told our young adults service a couple of weeks ago, they were doing this series called Gone Fishing, and they asked me to come back and teach them a little bit about fishing and evangelizing and using that illustration. I told everybody, I'm a country bumpkin. You know what I mean when I say country bumpkin? All right, I grew up in Yucaipa. Now, some of you are like, Pastor Luke, I am from Yucaipa. Let me say something. I grew up in Yucaipa before it was like Yucaipa that you know it, okay? When I grew up in Yucaipa, it was all about chicken ranches and cattle farms and rabbit ranches, and there was nothing there but foxtails and orange groves, okay? None of this suburbia and big schools, none of that was there, okay? It was nothing. And I remember riding in the back of the truck and all that kind of stuff, you know, in the country days when Dad was a contractor building the church at the same time. And I've always kind of been that. So in a sense, I call myself that country bumpkin. I like the outdoors. I'm an outdoor guy. I grew up when Mom and Dad were building the tent, when building the church. We remember my sister, Pastor Jessica, and I. We remember a summer. It was a great summer. We just thought it was a big long camping trip. We didn't realize that Dad was building the house and we didn't have anywhere to stay. So he just told us kids, "Hey, we're just camping out for the summer." And we lived in the tent for the summer. It was great. Well, that always just kind of stuck with me. My wife and I were real outdoorsy people, and so we just got back 5 days from backpacking in the High Sierras, and we went into this very remote place, over 12,000 foot passes to get to this lake that's really remote, really out there. And you know, we had a great time. The weather was terrible. As a matter of fact, I got a picture. I'll show you just a report. It's the only one that I could find where we didn't look tore up. So this is my wife and I, and this is our silly pose. And when it rains for 5 days straight, and all you have is a tent, you know, you have to be silly or you'll cry. So this is our silly pose, and we were out there backpacking, having a good time for 5 days. We took some friends from the church, and I tell you what, it was just amazing to just see God's country, the place where, you know, my friend said, you have to earn it, the view. You can't see this. Pictures don't do it justice, but you have to walk it. You have to get there by yourself, and when you do, it is worth every step. But I remember, you know, leading up to this, you know, my wife and I, we had gone on some backpacking trips before, and I was just generally dissatisfied with the stuff that I had. I mean, you have to carry everything you want. Your sleeping bag, your sleeping pad, your tent, your food, everything you need, you have to carry it. There's no amenities, there's no toilets or anything like that. You're like, what? I know. Country bumpkin, remember that, all right. And I remember I was just generally dissatisfied over the past couple of years with the system of things that I had. You know, my backpack was heavy. I'd come out of the wilderness and my hips would be bruised and my shoulders would have bruises on them and I wouldn't sleep and I'd be tired and asking myself, why am I doing this? Why is this fun? And you know, I got into researching. I got into looking into, okay, well, what would work better for me? And when I was researching and I was reading, I found some people's blogs about, you know, their experiences and what they do and what they use. And I started watching videos, and there were some places where people had seminars where somebody who had walked, you know, from Mexico to Canada for 6 months or something like that, and the systems that they used and what they found worked and what they didn't. And what I really began to find is that I was being influenced by a certain group of individuals. And as I was becoming influenced by them, I was beginning to tell everybody else, well, so-and-so says this about your backpacking. Well, you know, the U.S. Army put out a thing over here that says that a pound on your feet is like 5 pounds in your backpacking. And I realized that as I was researching, as I was giving my attention, my focus to knowing how to better this particular subject in my life, I found myself being incredibly influenced by a select group of people. And as I was being influenced by that select group of people, I found something very amazing, and that is this, that what influences me will eventually influence somebody else through me. And so today I want to talk about the subject of influence. And here's the whole meat of the message today, is what you allow to influence you will influence somebody else through you. So whether you take it in as a good or a negative, as a good influence or a bad influence, what you allow to influence you will influence somebody else through you. You know, we all seek for influence in our lives. You know, some of you say, Pastor Luke, I march to the beat of my own drum. I don't care what the world's doing. I don't care what's going on over here. I don't care what's going on over there. I don't let anybody influence me. But the truth of the matter is that every person in this auditorium tonight searches for influence in some form or fashion in our lives. Maybe you're looking for influence on how do I raise my kids? What is the latest trend when it comes to raising my children? What does Dr. Phil say about my family life? Or how do I make the most of my money? What is this guy over here? I was watching this YouTube video and the commercial popped up and we were talking about it a couple of days ago with some friends. The commercial popped up and a guy drives up in his Lamborghini and he says, "Yeah, I just wanted to show you my Lamborghini because 3 months ago I was homeless, but now I made so much money that I got a Lamborghini." We want to know, how did you do it? We're looking for influence. How do I make money? How do I raise my kids? How do I determine what success in life really is? We want to seek that out. What is true love? And we look at influence and reread the novels and we watch the movies and we look at the things that the world tells us that influence is and that tells us what to think and how to think and how to act and how to look and how to respond. You see, in our lives, we are bombarded every day by influence. Influence of ads, of commercials that say, drive this car and you've arrived. Influence of clothing or style, of fashion that say, wear these type of clothes and you'll fit in. Influence of colognes that smell like this, guys, and the girls will come running after you. Influence of finances. Well, follow this person's plan to get rich in 30 days and you will. Influences of children. And this is what the new scientific trend is for the books and you gotta, or the children, you gotta read this book. We are bombarded every day at every moment of our lives with influence. And what we allow to influence us will influence others around us through us. And so important what we allow to influence or what we look into. And when we're seeking this influence, whether you admit it or not, you're looking for influence. You're looking for answers. You're looking for how-tos. You're looking for solutions to your problems. And what you seek out will influence you. And what influences you will influence those around you through you. You will become that vessel. And so today I thought I'd look at the subject of this, and I was searching out and I was studying and the Word of God spoke to me and Jesus has given us a parable. And if you got your Bibles, you can turn with me to Luke in the 11th chapter. Luke in the 11th chapter, and Jesus is talking here, and I'll give you just a little bit of background. Jesus is preaching and lady shouts out, blessed is the womb that bore you and the breasts that fed you. Man, bless your mama, man. You are such an amazing guy. Your mama is blessed. And Jesus says, even more so, blessed is the person who hears what I'm saying and doesn't interrupt me. Amen. And does what I'm saying. And then he goes on and he begins to talk about the generation, the culture of the time. And I believe that culture of the time is so similar to our culture. He says it's an evil generation. It's a perverse generation. It's a generation that seeks a sign. You see, it's a generation that was looking for the BBD. You know what I mean by BBD? The bigger, better deal. They're looking for the next best thing. And they say, hey, show us a sign, Jesus. Show us a miracle and we'll believe. And Jesus says, you're an evil generation, a perverse generation that you seek a sign. He says, you don't realize that you're going to be judged. Why? Because the wisdom of Solomon is not even compared to what I have. He says, the message of Jonah, of repentance, Nineveh is not even close to what I have right now, but you are looking for a sign. You are seeking influence, but you are seeking with a closed heart. And so Jesus is heavy with this. And so he begins to speak to them and talks about that. In Luke in the 11th chapter, look what it says in verse number 33. This is where I believe the Lord spoke to me tonight about the subject of influence in this statement. He says, no one, when he has a lamp, puts it in a secret place or under a basket, but on a lampstand, that those who come may see the light. Now, you probably answered your question right now. Aha, I see now why this is my wife bought this for me. It's kind of a cool lamp. The little thing's covering it up, but I like to fish. All right. And so my wife, she went out there and she says, "I got to get you a man lamp." All right. All of our house has like, you know, kind of, it's not very manly, our house decoration. So I told my wife, I want my office to be my man cave. You know, I got a leather couch, man couch, and I got pictures of mountains. And she's got me this lamp here. It's a fishing pole. Jesus says, nobody who has a lamp hides it. They don't take the lamp and turn it off and put it underneath the table. Right? What good is that going to do? He says, if you've got a lamp and it's dark, what do? You turn the lamp on. In his day, you light it with a flame and you let it burn and you let it show. So he's talking about light. He's talking about illumination. He's talking about, he's using a metaphor here to describe to the people that he's talking to. He's giving them a descriptive illustration. And he says, nobody who has a lamp puts it in a secret place or under a basket, but on a lampstand, that those who come may see the light. Now he explains, the lamp of the body is the eye. Therefore, when your eye is good, your whole body also is full of light. But when your eye is bad, your body is full of darkness. Jesus is painting a picture right here for the people. He says, now when you're looking at wide-eyed in the light, you can see it. You can take it in. You can see all the details, all the shadows, everything that's going on. The light illuminates. But when your eye is bad, when you're looking at the light and you're squinting at it and you can't barely see and it's hidden and it's obscured somewhere else, he says, you're living in the darkness. But the lamp of the body is the eye. What you're looking at, what you're seeking for. And he's talking to a generation that is looking for influence, but they say, we'll allow you to influence us when you show us a sign. And Jesus says, man, it's not about a sign. It's about my words. It's about truth. It's about illumination. If you would hear what I say and do it, that would be a sign enough for you. But they're looking for something deeper. And so he goes on, therefore, take heed, look out, that the light which is in you is not darkness. The light which is in you is not darkness. Then if your whole body is full of light, having no part dark, listen to this, the whole body will be full of light as when the bright shining of a lamp gives you light. Jesus says, when you seek out influence, when you're searching for something, don't search out in darkness. Don't search out in the flesh. Don't search out in the condition of humanity that seeks a sign. He says, when you look for the light with an open and an honest heart, ready to receive the word of God, you will be illuminated not from the outside in, but from the inside out, and you will shine and reflect the glory of God. And Jesus is saying to you and I, watch, watch. Our influences. Why? Because what we allow to influence us, like the light that shines, will influence others through us. Your kids, what you allow to influence you will influence your children, not because you watched it, because they will see you. What you allow to influence you at work will influence others at your work through you. You are a living example of what to do or what not to do. And so this subject of influence for you and I is so important. It's so critical for us to understand how much weight is on us when it comes to this influence, because it is our responsibility to seek out the light with eyes open, with a heart ready to receive the word of God, to look for the influence of Christ, that we might be illuminated from the inside, that we might shine and influence others for the glory of God, rather than looking for the things of the flesh. How do I make money? How does the scientist or the psychologist tell me to raise my children? What's the best way to have success in life? Well, you know, my little brother, 15 years old, asked on a Friday night, if you were rich, what was the first thing you'd buy? It's like, that's the world telling you you've arrived. He says, I'd buy a Lamborghini something or other, Italian name. I couldn't even pronounce it. Don't even know what it is. You see, because that is the influence of the world saying, if you can own this car, you have arrived, and therefore you've made success. And what you allow to influence you will influence others through you. So it's so important that we understand how influence impacts our lives, but not just our lives, the lives of those around us, because ultimately we are here for a purpose. We are here for a reason, to reflect the glory of God. We have just one life here on earth to live. The Bible tells us it's a vapor. Therefore, we have to live it to the best we can for the ability and for the glory of the kingdom of God, and to not waste it seeking out things in darkness. Why? Because that will not shine a light for the world to see. So what we, it's so important, I say it 100 times tonight, what you allow to influence you will influence others through you. And so with that understanding, I wanted to just talk a little bit about this subject of influence and just what we can do as far as application. Okay, so now I know that there's an importance for influence in my life. That I have to understand that I'm going to influence people by what I allow to influence me. I'm going to talk about what I get into, what I see, what I open up. When my eyes are focused on or fixed on, will reflect to others around me. With that understanding in mind, what is it that I can do about this? And I want to just tell you some quick things out of the Word of God. If you've got your Bibles, go with me to the book of Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 4, Ephesians chapter 5 is just a great chapter, a couple of chapters as far as you and I, and when it comes to influence, when it comes to how we once were seeking out darkness, seeking a sign. Yesterday I was with a young man who just gave his heart to the Lord. And he says, man, I sure hope, you know, I've looked over here and I've looked over there. And man, I sure hope Jesus can help me. But you see, when we seek after Jesus with an open heart, when we realize, when I come with open eyes, like Jesus says, I'm looking at the light, I will see the light in all of its intensity and it will reflect on the inside of me. There's some things that we can understand. So I wanted to take you to Ephesians, the fourth chapter. Ephesians in the fourth chapter. Let's start in verse number 17. Ephesians chapter 4, verse number 17 says, this I say, therefore, and I testify in the Lord, that you should no longer walk as the rest of the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind, having their understanding darkened. You remember how Jesus was just talking about, we just read in Luke the 11th chapter. If you look at it with a dim eyes, with bad eyes, you will be dark on the inside. But if you look at it and there's no shadow on the inside of you, you will illuminate to the world. He says, having your understanding darkened, your eyes closed off to the things of God, being alienated from the life of God because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart. Very important. Look at this verse number 19. Who being past feeling. You see, oftentimes what happens to you and I in our lives, in our pursuit of influence and how to figure out the answer, what's the best way, what's the right way, what's the most correct or the fastest way, what happens to you and I is we become numb to the things around us. We get so fixed, we get so focused on our pursuit, on our answer, on our solution, that we get blinders on in our lives and we become numb. We've lost the feeling, we've lost the sensation to realize, hey, I'm headed down a wrong path. I'm allowing myself to be influenced by something that I should not be influenced because I'm not that kind of a person anymore. And he says, who, have being past feeling, have given themselves to lewdness, to work of uncleanliness, and to greediness. But you, now turns the page to you and I, but you, not so learned in Christ, if indeed you have heard him, and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning your former conduct, the old man which grows corrupt according to deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, that you put on the new man which was created according to God in true righteousness and holiness. Paul says some amazing things to you and I. He says, put off, separate, get away from it. But he says that you would renew your mind, that you would put on the Spirit, that you would remember, that you would recall who you are in Jesus Christ. You see, what Paul is telling you and I is that we have got to watch, we have got to guard through the Spirit of God what we allow in our lives. It is so important for us. Church, there are far too many Christians in the world, in America, in this building today, that are allowing things of the world, things of the flesh, the old man that is passing away, to continue to influence them, when in truth, we need to be influenced by who God has created us to be, the new man, the Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit on the inside of us, to watch, to guard what we allow in our lives. Just because it's on TV doesn't mean I can watch it. Just because somebody else is talking about it doesn't mean I need to join in the conversation. As a matter of fact, in the Bible, there's two great stories of two men that were influenced or not influenced by their people around them. One of the stories you know is probably very familiar to you. David, when he was anointed king, was hiding from Saul as Saul was incredibly jealous over David, the young warrior who had defeated Goliath. And now Israel is celebrating David. And there David is hiding in a cave with his mighty men. And the Bible, if you've ever heard the story, the Bible tells us that Saul went in to relieve himself. He had to go poo. And there David is in the cave. And David's mighty men, David's friends, his followers, the people that speak into his life are whispering into his ear at that moment, this is God's deliverance. Kill Saul. Kill Saul. Take your position. This is God putting Saul into your hands. But David said, no, I will not touch God's anointed. You see, David realized and recognized that there is a plan of God in his life, and he did not listen to the sources of influence that would try to lead him to kill, to murder Saul, when it seems like the obvious solution for David was to murder Saul. And then yet a couple of generations later, Rehoboam, David's grandson, after Solomon had died, the advisors of Israel come to Rehoboam and they say, listen, man, your daddy taxed us so hard. He worked us to death. If you would just loosen up on us, you would have a country, a nation that would be loyal to you, to serve you, to follow you wherever you would go. And Rehoboam says, let me consult. And there the elders, the ones who were there with his father say, listen, man, you ought to listen to the people. If you listen to them, you'll have a strong and a wise kingdom. And Rehoboam goes and he goes and he listens to his friends. And his friends say, you need to make a stand. You need to let them know that you thought my dad was bad. My dad's waist, my pinky finger is bigger than my dad's waist. That the afflictions and the bondages that my dad put you through aren't going to be anything compared to what I'm going to put you through. And Rehoboam listened to the influence of those around him. And guess what happened? The kingdom was split right in front of his eyes because he allowed influence to affect those around him. Church, we have got to guard. We have got to watch. We have got to keep a vigilant watch. That's why the Bible tells us over and over and over again to be sober, to be vigilant, to be awake. Don't be slack in life. Don't let your guard down. Why? Because what you allow to influence you will influence others through you. Which means that if you allow something into you as a parent, your children will catch it from you, not the TV. Say, man, that TV is teaching them all sorts of words. Hello, they're learning it from you. We just don't want to admit it. Man, my boss, he's coming down on me. Everybody, they're just a terrible boss. Hello, they're watching it because you're listening to everybody else gripe about how bad of a boss they are. Some of us in this place, listen, myself included, I have allowed people to speak into my life, to say things. I have given them my ear, knowing that what they are saying is leading me down a path that is contrary to the ways and the will of God. And we as Christians have got to make a stand to watch, to guard what we allow in our lives. To say, I won't watch that on television. I won't put that app on my phone. I won't listen to that conversation over here. I'm not going to partake of this over there. I'm not going to talk like that anymore. I'm not going to join in on this dirty joke over here. I'm not going to do those things anymore. Why? Because I will not allow those to influence me. Why? Because I don't want that to influence somebody else. What we allow to influence us will influence others through us. So we've got to watch, to keep guard of what we allow to influence us. You're in Ephesians, the 4th chapter. Go with me to Ephesians, the 5th chapter. Ephesians chapter 5. Paul again talks about this, and I want to read to you again now in verse number 8. Ephesians chapter 5, probably just a page over from where you're at. Paul says this, for you were once darkness. There it is again. Jesus telling us that when you look at the light, when you seek after the light with open eyes, you'll see the light. But when you look with a bad eye, with a dark heart, with the flesh, with the eyes of the flesh, with the eyes of that perverse and that evil generation that says, show me a sign. He says, you were once darkness, but now are light in the world. You have seen the illumination of Jesus Christ. It has come on the inside of you now, and you are reflecting the glory of God for the world to see. He says, walk as children of the light. Verse number 9.
For the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness, righteousness, and truth, finding out what is acceptable to the Lord, and have no fellowship. Listen to this. Have no fellowship. Have no fellowship. Have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather expose them. Light exposes darkness. You are called to be a shining beacon of the glory of God. When you get into a dark room, if you've ever had cockroaches, la cucarachas. And you turn on the light, guess what? It exposes them. They don't like it. That's your calling in life, is to let the world know how evil, evil is. That evil is not good. Your calling is to expose the evil of this world by shining the light that Jesus Christ has put on the inside of you. But what you allow to influence you will influence others through you. And so he says, have no fellowship with darkness. Have no association with darkness. Don't play. Don't dabble. Don't walk the line. Walk the fence. Whatever Johnny Cash sang, don't even get close to it. But all things that are exposed are made manifest, are shown by the light, for whatever makes manifest is light, which is us. Therefore, he says, awake, you who sleep. Arise from the dead. You and I were once dead, but now are life in Christ. And Christ will give you light. He says, have no fellowship with darkness. You see, proximity affects influence. Proximity affects influence. What you are close to will influence you. What you are close to will influence you. Well, I'm close to the TV. Guess what? TV will influence me. I'm close to my friends over here talking about this or that. Guess what? My friends over here talking about this or that are going to influence me. I'm close to what's going on in the latest psychological trend for raising my children. Guess what? That's going to influence you, because proximity affects influence. What you are close to will influence you. Conversely, on the other end, what you separate from, what you withdraw from, will no longer influence you. Listen, my wife and I, we were just 5 days in the wilderness with no cell phone reception, with no internet. Oh my gosh. Do you remember the days when you didn't have internet? It's like, we didn't even know what to do. As a matter of fact, our friends that we went through the first night, she's like, I don't know what to do. I used to look at my phone. Hey, you got to find something else to do. The news didn't influence me. What was going on social media that day didn't influence me. What was happening, going, you know, when I got the reports of this or that, when somebody sent an email to me, didn't influence me. Why? Because I didn't get it. Why? Because I was disconnected. Proximity affects influence. There's a story. You might have heard the story. There's a young man in the Bible. His name is Joseph. Joseph was a young Hebrew. He was sold into slavery by his brothers because his brothers hated him. They were jealous of him, and he found himself in the position of slavery to a man by the name of Potiphar. And Potiphar saw that everything that Joseph touched, the Bible says, was blessed. And Potiphar put Joseph over everything in his house, all of his household affairs. And the Bible begins to say, that tells us that Pharaoh, or Potiphar's wife, began to have the hots for Joseph. So she comes to Joseph one day and she says, come and lie with me. And Joseph says, how can I sin against my master and God? Joseph, you know what he did? He ran. He ran. She grabbed his cloak, all right? If you look at Egyptian pictures, just imagine, all right, he had a skirt on, right, or a kilt. We'll call it a kilt. He ran. She grabbed it. He kept on running. Joseph split the scene. Why? Because proximity affects influence. Joseph said, I'm not even going to put myself in the situation. This lady's trying to tempt me. She's a cougar coming after me. I'm going to get out of here now. On the other hand, there's another story of David. The Bible says David, at a time when kings should have gone to war, David was at home resting, taking a sick day, calling in a personal day. I just can't make it today. You ever seen that little meme? Some of you are on social media, a little meme of the dog laying flat. It's like, I can't be an adult today. That was David today. I can't do it. I can't king today. David's just at home. David goes up on the rooftop.
And there he's taking in the sun. He sees a beautiful lady on the rooftop over, taking a bath, naked on the rooftop. Instead of doing what Joseph did, what does David do? He stays. He takes in the sights, looks at it a little bit. Oh, yeah, she's pretty good. All right, cool. Call somebody over. Hey, man, come here, come here, come here. Look at this. Hey, look at her. Yeah, man.
Dang.
David, you should be at war. I know, but I'm glad I stayed home. What's her name? Oh, her name is Bathsheba. She's the wife of Uriah. Well, why don't you call Bathsheba over to my house? And you know the story. David gets Bathsheba pregnant. Ends up murdering Uriah, her husband, trying to cover up his sin. And David pays a severe consequence. Why? Because proximity affects influence. You heard Pastor Dan talking about, if you were at message today, you know, Jesus, he was witnessing to sinners all day long. But listen, if you're struggling with drinking, you're not going to go witness to sinners in a bar. Why? Because proximity affects influence. And I'll just meddle for a moment. There are some of you in this place today. You are too close to people that you don't need to be close to anymore. You are too close to people that you don't need to be close to anymore. But Pastor Luke, they're my family. They're my best friends. I've known them since elementary school. We've done everything together. Proximity affects influence. And the closer you are to negative influence, like David, the more you become influenced by it, and you will begin to influence others by what you have been influenced by. And some of you in this place today need to draw a line in the sand. To say, you know what? I may not be able to escape you because you're family or because you're coworkers, but I don't have to stand next to y'all when you're talking about the boss. I don't have to come over to the water cooler. I don't have to join in on that Facebook conversation. I don't have to listen to what you guys are saying. I can go over here and I can get my work done. And then instead of leaning around, like the boss says, if you got time to lean, you got time to clean, I will be an example. Why? Because I am not influenced by that conversation, that group of people, those homies anymore. I am influenced by Jesus Christ. See, we've got to watch what we allow to influence us. Some of you guys need to change the channel. Turn the internet off. Disconnect your cable. Some of you need to hand the remote away. Some of you need to stop listening to that talk radio. Some of you need to cut off those friendships. Why? Because what you stay close to will affect you, and you will begin to affect others through influence. You see, we are called to be influential people. What it all comes down to for you and I, think about it for a moment. I'll take you back in history. I love history. I'm a history buff. 30 AD, Jesus Christ dies on the cross. 270 years later, the greatest empire of the world has ever seen, the Roman Empire, is overturned from their pagan ways and accepts Christianity, in which they persecuted for 270 years. They accept Christianity as the national religion. You see, Rome was overtaken. Rome was overturned by Christians around the world who never once picked up a sword to fight or to invade the kingdom, but rather influenced the Roman government and the Roman emperors and the Roman citizens and the people of the world in the name of Jesus, because they were influenced by Jesus. Because what you allow to influence you will influence others through you. And the church 2,000 years ago allowed a young man named Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for their sins, to influence them. And because they allowed him to influence them, they began to influence the world through him. And in 270 years, without picking up a sword, overturned the pagan systems of the world's greatest empire. You see, this world, it boils down to this. This world's not going to change from the United Nations. They can try all they want. They're not going to change the world. Political correctness. Stop saying offensive things. That's not going to change the world. Social justice. That's not going to change the world. We've seen it already fail. The only thing that's going to change this world is influence of Jesus Christ. Because what we allow to influence us will influence others through us. And when Jesus, on the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew, the fifth chapter, says that you are the light of the world, a city that is set on a hill that cannot be hidden, nor do they light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light for all to see, illuminating the world to see. Why? Verse number 16. Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Amen. This world's only going to change, church, when we stop allowing it to influence us. This world's only going to change when we stop allowing it to speak into our lives. This world's only going to change when we draw a line in the sand and we start to watch what we allow to affect us. And we begin to separate ourselves. As Pastor Dan talked about today, the Bible tells us to be holy as he is holy. Holy is set apart. We are no longer associated with this world. Paul says we are dead to the world, but now alive in Christ, a new creation. Like he said in Ephesians, the fourth chapter, now all of a sudden I begin to renew my mind. I don't think like that. I don't participate in that. I'm not going to hang around that. I'm not going to associate with that. Why? Because Jesus will be he who affects me. And because Jesus influences me, now I will influence the world because Jesus has influenced me. And now all of a sudden, this world, this nation, your family, your children, your job, your finances, your success, your happiness, your love, everything in your life that you are seeking after and you are pursuing after will begin to change. Why? Because what you allow to influence you will influence others through you. Either the systems and the things of this world or through Jesus Christ. In his words, like he said to that lady who said, blessed is your mama. He says, no, blessed is the person who hears what I say and does it. When we allow Jesus Christ to influence us, we will begin to influence others through Jesus Christ. And this world will really start to change. But it starts by us watching what we allow to influence us, to set ourselves aside because we're holy, to get away, to distance ourselves, to run like Joseph from the things that affect us negatively and run to the things that affect us positively like Jesus. The Word of God, church services, music, whatever it might be. Get into Christ and Christ will get into you, like Jesus says. You look at the lamp and the lamp will illuminate you. And because you are illuminated, you will shine for the world to see. And you will begin to influence others by what influenced you. We can change this world. We say every service, the Inland Empire shall be saved. Guess what? We can see that come to pass. Because we allow Jesus to illuminate us so that we get out there into a dark city and illuminate it through Jesus Christ. Did you guys get something out of the Word of God today? Amen. God is so good. God is so good. Amen. Hey, listen, before we leave today, I want to just take a quick moment. I don't know every one of you in this place. I wish I did. That would be so neat if we all knew each other and it was all cool. But I don't know every one of you in this place. As a matter of fact, there are many of you that were here for the first time. And it would be a shame for us to leave under the pretenses that everybody in this room is in the right place and in the right position with God, when the truth is that there are those of you in this place today that need to examine your heart, to examine your life, and to check out where you stand with God. You see, the Bible tells us that we ought to examine ourselves from time to time. And so I want to ask you a question. And I want you to answer it within your heart. You see, nobody will know the answer except you and God, so don't beat around the bush. Don't try to make it better than it is. Answer it honestly today in your heart. And the question is simply this. If you were to leave tonight, and heaven forbid it be the case, but if you were to leave tonight and you were to die, would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? It's a very simple question, but you see, how you arrive at your conclusion, what you say and your answer has a lot to say about your position and your right standing with God. And today I want to give you the opportunity to examine your life. And so let's go over some of those answers that you might have said in your head today. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can hope? Man, a lot of people, when I ask them, what do you think about that? They say, man, I hope I'm going to go to heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that you can hope, that you can want, or that you can think, or you can desire, that you can wish? Like the little trainee thought, I think I can. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you can get to heaven because of that? Because of your mindset? Because you've got the most positive outlook on life? Nowhere in the Word of God will you find that you can hope, wish, want, or think your way into heaven. So often what happens is when we think, well, you know, I'm in church. I'm sitting in church today. I hear the pastor preach. I came on Christmas. I came on Easter. I come every once in a while. And here I am today. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you attend a church service, because you hear the pastor preach, because you sing a couple of praise and worship songs, or you listen to 90.1 on the radio, does that mean that you're going to get into heaven? Nowhere in the Word of God does it say that because you listen to Christian music, hear the pastor preach, or sit in church, that you're going to get to heaven. It doesn't say that in the Word of God. You're not going to find it. So often we say, well, Pastor Luke, as a child, I was baptized. My parents took me to church and they baptized me or they christened me. And, you know, I went to Sunday school or catechism classes. All my life growing up, I was in church. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you were baptized as a baby? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you went to Sunday school or catechism classes? Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents took you to church and told you that you, when you were growing up, that you were a Christian? Well, Christians go to heaven. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because your parents told you, because you were baptized, you're a Christian? Well, Pastor Luke, all my life I've given myself the title of Christian. I've always thought I was a Christian. When the census came knocking on my door, I marked Christian. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you've given yourself a label? Because you've called yourself a Christian, that means you're going to get to heaven. You know, that's like me, Americans, man. We love in our day and age to label ourselves, to associate with something or the other. That's like me saying, you know what, I'm going to label myself a Dodger. I'm going to go to Sports Chalet. I'm going to buy all the Dodgers uniform and the hat and the garb and the jersey, and I'm going to go try to sit in the Dodgers dugout. Did you know that no matter how much I think I'm a Dodger because I've given myself a label doesn't mean I'm a part of the Dodgers organization? Take me out of that dugout, and they're going to lock me up because I'm a kooky fan. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you've given yourself a title, because you've given yourself a label, because you've called yourself a Christian all your life, it means you're going to get to heaven. Well, but Pastor Luke, I was a leader in my church. I carried the pastor's Bible. I volunteered in the children's ministry or the youth ministry. I even sang on the stage at my last church. As a matter of fact, I even have a card in my wallet that says I'm a member to a church. Did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that you can get into heaven because you're volunteering, because you're involved, because you help out, because you have a card in your wallet that says you're a member because you carried the pastor's Bible? Listen, pastor's not going to save you. By being close to somebody who's saved doesn't mean that you're going to get saved. Doesn't mean it doesn't work that way. You're not going to find that in the Bible. Boy, but Pastor Luke, I got you here. I'm a good person. I've never done bad things. I've never robbed a 7-Eleven. As a matter of fact, I've done more good in my life than I've done bad. I try to help out my fellow human beings. I stay close to my family. I've even given to social justice causes or took a stand for somebody who was getting beat up one time. Did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that because you're a good person, because you live to try to help out your fellow human being, because you take a stand for social justice or whatever it might be, did you know that nowhere in the Bible does it say that you're going to get to heaven because of those things? So often in America, all we think is all we got to do is be a good person and good people go to heaven, but it doesn't say that anywhere in the Bible. As a matter of fact, the Bible does tell us that our good deeds, according to God's righteousness, is like filthy rags. Nothing you could ever do on your own would ever make you good enough to get into heaven. Why? Because you can't earn it. You can't work for it. You don't deserve it. You can't buy it. The only thing you can do is accept it. God's way. It's God's heaven. It's His way. Jesus Christ is that way. Jesus says that He is the way, the truth, and the life. No one goes to the Father except through Him. So today, I want to give you that opportunity. Jesus, in the book of John, in the third chapter, He's talking to a religious man. A man who gave to the poor, did all the right things, said all the right things. A man who lived according to the scripture, did everything he could to live the right way. Jesus says this, unless you're born again, you cannot see the kingdom of God. Today I want to give you the opportunity. Jesus says these important words. Born again, what does that mean? Well, it's not what Hollywood, society, the movies have made it out to be. Born again from the beginning of the Bible to the end of the Bible has always meant the same thing in the eyes and the heart of God. It means that you've given Him all of your heart. You've given Him all of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with God the Father through His Son, Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, in the book of Revelation, Jesus, His final plea to the church, says, you think you're wealthy, you think you're rich, you don't realize how naked and how destitute you are, He says, and I'm paraphrasing, He says, oh, I wish that you would come and buy from me. He says, I'm coming back. When I come back, I'd rather find that you're hot or I'd rather find that you're cold, because if I find that you're lukewarm, He says, I will vomit you from my mouth. It's a shocking statement, a statement designed to get our attention. You see, it's His final plea to the church, to you and I, to say, stop doing life your way and start doing life my way. Stop relying on your systems and start relying on me. There are those of you in this place today that you've been relying on your own way too long, and it's time to surrender your heart, to surrender your life. What does it mean to be lukewarm? Lukewarm simply means that you've got your ups and your downs and your ins and your outs. You're not wholehearted for God. You're not wholehearted against God. You're kind of riding the fence, doing your own thing when you come to church, or when somebody who's a Christian's around you. Hey, I'm a Christian, but when they're gone, you're doing your own thing. Come on, you know who you are. I love you enough, I respect you enough, I honor you enough to tell you the truth today. You're not going to make it. But that doesn't have to be the final answer. because you have breath in your lungs today. Jesus said these words in John, the 10th chapter. He says, I have come to give you life, and that you might have life more abundantly. Many of you in this place today, you've been seeking answers. You've been looking for influence. You've been trying to fill the emptiness and the void on the inside of your life with food, with friends, with possessions, with money, with whatever it might be. Only to realize that no matter how much you try to fill the emptiness that you're feeling on the inside, you can never quench the thirst. Why? Because it's a God-sized hole meant to be filled with Jesus Christ. And today, it's time for you to stop running from God and start running to God. And it starts by accepting the invitation. See, Jesus says that he is the way, the truth, and the life. Like I said, no one goes to the Father except through him. Jesus says these words. He says that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. But he goes on, he says, but if you deny me, I will deny you. The decision is yours. God's not a manipulator or a conniver. He's not going to force his way or make his way. And today, it's your choice. The Bible tells us that the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. Like any gift, you have a choice. Are you going to accept that gift? Or are you going to return or reject it? It's your free will choice today. Today I want to give you the opportunity to accept the gift of Jesus Christ. In a moment, I'll count to three. Here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to go to count to three. I'll go one, two, and I count to three. I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. When I do, if that's you in this place today, I'm speaking to you and you know who you are by the Spirit of God. I'm speaking to you today. I'm going to ask you to do something real bold. I'm going to ask you to pop your hand up. We'll do it all together at the same time. What you're doing by raising your hand is you're making a decision. You're saying, you know what? I want to follow God. I want to give God all of my heart. I want to give God all of my life today. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. You say, Pastor Luke, if I raise my hand, I'm going to be embarrassed. You might be, but I'm not going to embarrass you. I promise. What you're doing is you're making a decision to follow Jesus Christ today. Who should raise your hands? If you've never given your heart, you've never given your life to Jesus. In just a moment, if that's you, come on. This is your moment. This is your time. Who should raise your hands if you're in this place today? You're not sure. Maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group, or you went to that Harvest Crusade, or you prayed that prayer once before on TV, but you've never really followed through with it. Listen, come on, if that's you in this place, don't walk out of here tonight without making sure of your eternal position with God. Who should raise your hands if you've been living lukewarm, doing your own thing instead of God's thing? Come on, guys, if you've been playing games, doing the church thing on Sunday, doing your own thing the rest of the day, that is not a way to live. It's a terrible position to be in. And it's time for you to accept life in Jesus Christ by giving him all of your heart and giving him all of your life, not just some of it. The decision starts today. It's in your hands. All across this auditorium, from the side to side, from the front to the back, you guys in the family rooms, I can see you there through the windows. Even if you're at home right now watching on the live stream, watching on your phone or your mobile device or on your computer, there's a little button. If you minimize the browser or the video, you can click the blue button. It says, no, God. Hands are already going up. I see you, my man. We'll count together. We'll do it all together in just a moment, but I see you. If that's you, you can click that button as well. In a moment, when I count to three, like I've already seen hands going up, if that's you in this place today, it's time for you to stop playing games, stop messing around, and accept the gift of Jesus Christ and eternal salvation. Ensure your destiny with God in paradise and accept life here on earth today. It starts by making that decision. Somebody say, man, I don't even know why you're here. You are here for this very moment, right here, right now. It's a divine appointment. If anything else you listen to today, listen to this. This is your moment. This is your time. The day of your salvation is here. I'm going to count to three, and when I do, pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down, and we'll go forward together. I've already seen hands going up. So if that's you in this place, get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. Are you ready? Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place today. All right. See, one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. I got you. Two hands right there. All right. Eight wise people. Anybody else in this place? I got you back there. All right. I got you back there, my man. Eight wise people, 9, 10, 11, 12. Cool, awesome, I see you guys. Anybody else in this place, you say, man, I wonder if I should. See, I haven't embarrassed anybody today yet. This is your moment, this is your time. I wonder if I should, you should. Spirit of God speaking to you. The Bible says it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. It's not Pastor Luke, hey. It's not me, it's God speaking to you. It's time for you to respond. Anybody else in this place today, 12 wise people, I didn't embarrass them, I won't embarrass you. I'm gonna close it up right now so we can go have Krispy Kreme donuts. Well, hey, let's praise God for 12 wise people. Amen. Here's what we're going to do. For all 12 of you that raised your hands, you guys over there in the back, I saw you. If you raise your hands, you say, you know what? I'm making a decision. Every decision requires action. Otherwise, it goes nowhere. You know that. You've made decisions and never acted on them before. We're going to follow through together. We're going to act on this together. We're going to pray a prayer, change destinies together right here, right now. So if you raised your hand, or maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have. If that's you in just a moment, we'll all stand. And as we all stand, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, your Bible. A friend, if you need a friend, if you raise your hand and you got family members, look at them and say, you know what, I'll come with me. Or if you see somebody that raised their hand, say, come on, I'll go with you. And get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle and come meet me right here at this altar. We're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So let's all stand together. Nobody leave at this time. If you raised your hand or you should have raised your hand, come on, get out of your seat. Come meet me up here right now. Let's change destinies together today.
Lord, I give you my heart. I give you my soul. I
That's you in this place today. You come, come on.
I'm away. Lord, have your way in me. Lord, I give you my heart.
They're still coming. We'll wait for you. You're worth waiting for. God, you guys came, man, and somebody needs to tell you first and foremost, good job. You are making a great decision, the very best decision you could possibly make as a human being. I mean, you are accepting life. Maybe you've never had somebody encourage you in your life, but somebody needs to tell you, you know what, you're doing a good job. Right on. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy right over here, real cool, waving at you in his jean jacket? His name is Pastor Joel. Pastor Joel is a really neat guy. He's going to take you guys just right over there. Listen, nothing weird goes on, I promise, okay? I'm as weird as it gets. He made it through me. He's going to take you guys right over there. Here's what he's going to do. I'll tell you what he's going to do. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved by raising your hand. You get saved by inviting Jesus to be the Lord and Savior of your life. What does that mean, Lord and Savior? We don't talk like that anymore. The leader of your life, okay? Secondly, he's going to do, you don't want to leave you empty-handed. You're going to leave this place today with some literature, some real easy reading. You walk out of this place and say, man, I raised my hand. I prayed that prayer. Now what do I do? We're going to point you in the right direction. The third thing he's going to do is he's going to introduce you to a friend here at church. We call them spiritual personal trainers. I went to the gym a couple of weeks ago. I didn't know how to use any of that equipment. But somebody came alongside me and says, this is how you do it, so you don't look like a fool. They're called a personal trainer. A spiritual personal trainer is a friend, somebody that will meet with you right here at church, buy you a cup of coffee, get you a soda in our Love Rock Cafe for a couple of minutes, for just a couple of weeks, teach you some things about the ways of God, not joining some big, long program, but you're just meeting with a friend to get strong in the ways of God so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything that God has for you. So if you guys would just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my friend Pastor Joel. The party will be here afterwards. They'll dismiss you in just a moment. Congratulations. Hallelujah.
Hey, you just heard that altar call. You just wanted to give God all of your heart and all of your life. Now let me lead you simply in a prayer of inviting Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior. In fact, why don't you just go ahead and listen to me and go ahead and close your eyes and just repeat these words after me. I'll go slow, you repeat them. Say these words. Say, Father God, I come to you in the name of Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ is your only begotten Son and that you sent him for me and that he died for me on that cross at Calvary. I believe that his blood washes away my sins, that I am now a new creature in Christ Jesus. And I thank you, Lord. I receive you now and forever as my Lord and as my Savior. I'm going to turn from sin, and I'm going to turn with all of my heart and all of my life to you, Jesus, as my Lord and as my Savior. Let it be known in heaven as well as upon the earth that I am born again. I'm a child of God, that I'm saved, and I'm headed for heaven and denying my presence in hell. Thank you, Jesus. I'm alive forevermore. Love you so much. God bless you guys. Everybody just say amen and receive Christ as your Lord and Savior. So talk to you later. God bless you.
Thank you for listening to the Rock Church and World Outreach Center. If this message spoke to you, please share it with us. We'd love to hear from you. You can find more information at www.rockchurch.com.